afternoon, everybody. I am really excited to introduce Nate Delson today. I think it's true that Nate probably does more to make the School of Engineering here awesome than almost anybody else. I mean, Nate's been involved in, I think, most of the really exciting things in the School of Engineering. A lot of you know about the makerspace and all the work that Nate's done to help make that happen and herd cats and all of that stuff. Nate is also an alumnus of UC San Diego. He got his undergraduate degree here before going to MIT, where he has a PhD in mechanical engineering from MIT there. And then he realized that the West Coast was the best coast, so he came back. And today, Nate's actually going to talk about a recent NSF-funded research project that he's been working on using sketching to teach visualization. So thanks so much for being here.
Thank you so much, Scott. So first of all, I wanted to thank Scott and the organizers of this conference for this opportunity, because it is true, I'm a mechanical engineer. Typically, I build contraptions, but in the last few, and if I use software, it's to do some analysis on engineering. I never thought I really would get into commercial software development and worried about user experience and that whole aspect of it. But in the last few years, I have, and it's been such an enrichment for me to see how well that's treated here at UCSD. And we've benefited a lot from people coming from the lab here, so it's really a pleasure to present in this forum. And I wanted to share with you today both what we've done and also the little pathway of how we got involved and those little tidbits of serendipity that helped the project move along. Because I think it's kind of always interesting to look back and wonder where you are and how you got there. So I'm going to talk a little bit about spatial visualization and freehand sketching, why we're even interested in that, why that's important. Then the next bit is this app that we developed at UCSD, and we're starting to commercialize it. But I want to talk about what lessons we learned from the user experience, what lessons we learned from, we're just beginning our commercialization effort, and then it wouldn't have been possible without a lot of effort and a lot of teams. So let's talk about this one. So spatial visualization is manipulation of 2D and 3D images. So let's put our attention on this question right here. This is a sample question from a standardized test. This shape here is rotated to this shape as this is rotated to one of these. So just take a moment and see if you can make a guess at which one it is. How many people say A? B? C, D, you got D, and E. That is correct, it is D. If you had a vertical axis here, this would rotate clockwise 90 degrees, and if we rotate this 90 degrees, it's there. So people have been studying this for many years in cognitive science, and they found out that if you're good at these tests, and it can get pretty hard, especially when you rotate about this axis and then that axis, and the more degrees it gets, it's harder and harder. And they found that if you happen to be better at this skill, then you're better at science, technology, engineering, and math. And there are many careers, from medicine to computer gaming. In fact, more and more, there was a study, I think, that 64 careers where it's important. And I look back, that was done in 1967. And now I think it's probably many hundreds of careers use this. But it's not really taught. You probably didn't have a class in spatial visualization, at least not before college. So people wonder, how do people develop spatial skills? So it turns out that if you ask people, do they play a lot with Lego, and now 3D games, specifically Minecraft, if you have siblings or nieces or nephews in elementary school, they probably play Minecraft. But again, it's not typically taught. But not everybody plays as much with Lego and video games. And so there's some people that skill is weaker, and there's still that correlation with performance in math and science. Now it turns out there's a gender component and also other underrepresented minorities in math and science. And it's interesting a little bit because this is kind of how it started. I think in 2010, I read an article in the New York Times, and it was about this report, why so few women in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And it was basically, their conclusion was that if you have underdeveloped skills, and it turns out in general, if on average, not across the board, but on average, women, girls have lower spatial skills, they score lower on these standardized tests than the boys do. And they felt that that may deter them from pursuing math or science, and they specifically referenced a researcher, Professor Sorby, who did some studies. So actually in 2010, I went back actually today and I looked at my emails and I read that article and I emailed them and I got interested in this just from reading the newspaper. And I learned more about what Professor Sorby did, and she did an interesting study. Well, she felt herself that she had an experience like that. She wasn't strong in spatial skills, and she felt that this was one reason that made it hard, especially when engineering students get to CAD classes. CAD is computer-aided design, computer-aided drafting. You have to draw in three dimensions. It can be difficult because you're using a 2D mouse and you have a 2D screen and you really have to understand what's going on. And she felt to her it was like a foreign language. So she decided to do something about it. Because the question was, just as you guys I'm sure know, just because there's a correlation between spatial skills, spatial visualization skills, and ability in math and science doesn't mean that it's a causal effect. We all know that. So she felt that there was a causal effect, but she had to show that. So she developed a one-unit class in spatial visualization training. And what she did, because at that point she was chair of her department, she dictated that every incoming engineering student has to take a standardized spatial visualization test. It turns out it was important that she required that. Earlier on, actually, she didn't require it because statistically it was important that everybody who was required, and I think if they scored under 60%, they had to take her test. If they scored above it, they didn't. So this was the graduation rate within engineering at the university. So if you failed but did not take the course, I guess that was done beforehand or for some reason they didn't do it, then your graduation rate was less than 50%. If you did really well at 70% or higher, a high pass, then you graduated at 70%. The average rate of graduation, incoming freshmen going into an engineering major, average rate across the country is 50%. The interesting result here is that these people, they're called barely passes. They passed between 60 to 70%. They didn't have to take the course. These people failed. They were initially under 60, but they took the course, and so they leapfrogged. They kind of went from this spot to that spot. And because it was required, a lot of times when you do studies to improve education, we hear about many studies from Common Core to Persistence and so on, and you do an initiative, and the results look really good, but then you try to duplicate it, and sometimes the effects drop. And one of them, if it's an optional effort that you're doing in education, you have self-selection bias. Those students who are interested in improving themselves, interested in working harder, they take an optional class, or an optional, they do more homework, they sit in the front of the class. You've probably heard many things that help, but if it's optional, you self-selected, those people are more motivated anyway. So when Professor Sorby did the studies, especially later, when she became chair of the department, her studies were rigorously statistically. And so the NSF got very excited about this, and they started funding spatial visualization classes. And this became the motivation for the project that we started. Now, another component about spatial visualization is freehand sketching. So here's a freehand sketch. Does anybody recognize this? The laser. Okay. So this was the first design of a laser sailboat. It was a racing sailboat that was designed to be low cost. You can put it on the roof of your car, so you didn't need a trailer. Eventually, it became an Olympic class sailboat. And this was the initial drawing: a side view, a top view, some calculations about sail area and maybe water line and so on. It's called the $1 million doodle. So even though we have all these fancy computer packages, people still use freehand sketching. You've heard that before, but what Sorby showed is that physical act of sketching, she did a class with just multiple choice questions and a class with also the freehand sketching, that physical act of drawing things, top view, side view, three-dimensional views, all of those things helped with your spatial visualization skills. And it's much quicker, and it's using teamwork and brainstorming. I thought I'd show a picture here. This is a student at UCSD drawing in our team project, and this led to Hutch Technology, one of the startups. Actually, Dr. Koonin here helped with them. And so if you're working with a team, you don't necessarily have time always to come up with doing a CAD model. So that ability to draw is very important, but we don't always teach it. So let's talk a little bit about, that's why spatial visualization is important, freehand sketching is important, how do we end up at touchscreen? So I thought that was an interesting story. So in 2010, I read this New York Times article, I sent an email to Professor Sorby. I was at an engineering education conference. She was presenting on spatial visualization. I thought I'd show up and I'd see her work, and I showed her all those plots were showing how effective it was. So it was so great, so I went up to her and I said, you know, introduced myself. I said, you know, I teach introductory design. I really like what you're doing. I've actually incorporated some of your material. I have like 1 week, we spend a few lectures on spatial visualization because I thought it was an important topic. So she looked at me and she said, you're doing more harm than good. So first of all, it's good that she was very direct, but her point was that if the spectrum is all over the place in terms of spatial ability. It's not like everybody has to learn math. Everybody has to learn English to get into college, but there's no test on spatial visualization. If you do a few assignments on spatial visualization 1 week, some students who are already good are going to love it, and those people who are weak are going to feel even less capable. So I said, geez, I got to do something better than that. So I came back all energized, and I sent that. It was interesting. I didn't put it on the slide, but I thought I meant it. I came back, and there were some other people at the conference. They didn't go to that presentation, and I shot off an email with the title, Spatial Visualization, and the title, We Really Should Do Something. So I didn't hear back from either of those faculty, so that's fine. We all get busy. We do our thing. And maybe about half a year later, a few months later, Cal IT2 had a research opportunity, and the director there, Ramesh Rao, mentioned to somebody, maybe they should look at spatial visualization. So that person looked into that, was looking for that email and typed in that term, and that was one of the persons I had emailed to. And so with a little bit of serendipity, we connected and we did the funding. So I think the message is that it's important to get motivated about what's important, but funding definitely helps, and institutional support definitely helps, and we wouldn't be here without it.
Hey, Nate. Yes? Do you actually know whether doing a little bit does more harm than good? Because, I mean, there's certainly some times where if you give people a taste, that turns off those that don't have prior background and turns on those that do. And there are other times, like, I feel like teaching soldering for an hour. Mm-hmm. You know, if you teach it for an hour, that really raises the floor, and so you're doing more good than harm. And, so I wouldn't automatically assume that a little is worse than nothing.
Well, I would never not learn something because I'm not an expert. I would, if it was my kid, a little bit of driving me, you know, I wouldn't turn them loose. I don't know, but I can tell you this, okay, that if I'm in a classroom of 200 students, okay, as an instructor, instructors like to feel good, right? And so we teach it, and then I give some brain teasers. The brain teasers are kind of hard. And maybe 10%, 20% of the students come up and they show me that they got the brain teaser and they work really hard on it and I feel kind of good because I'm challenging them. And I have no clue if I'm doing harm. So I think that I don't know if we're doing harm or good, but as an instructor, it's easy to fool ourselves with that. And that some people feel very strongly about this. And there's a big debate about whether they should have the class just for the low spatial visualization skill people, or whether it should have it. And I hear these debates go back and forth and back and forth. So I don't know if it's an easy test to study, but that's a good point. So touch screens. So if everybody thinks that spatial visualization is good to learn, talk about adding things to the classroom. How many people have extra time these days? Not that many people, right? And they're trying to cut time to graduation, and you keep on saying, add something to the curriculum. It's not easy to do, right? I mean, we should all learn Latin, and we should do this, and we should do that. And so we wanted to make it easier to learn, If you're learning multiple choice stuff, you can do that online. But spatial visualization, we knew that we had to do the freehand sketching. The way it was being taught, the way it was being promoted by the NSF throughout universities about the United States is everybody does an assignment on a piece of paper, they turn it into the instructor, and they get it back a week later. Just around that time, I had noticed some of my students starting to bring iPads to their TA meetings, and they were taking their engineering notes on the iPads. I didn't have an iPad at that time, but I started looking at them and asking about that, and I put the two together. Why don't we do sketching on the iPad? And that's what we did. And the idea is it automatically grades it, so it gives you immediate feedback, not a weak feedback. If you make a mistake, you can try again. We made it so you can get a hint if you get stuck. This is what I used to do with a T-square. I don't think you guys did that anymore. I use the 30-90 triangle. And the teacher can see how students are doing, and students get engaged because they can just get immediate feedback. So we have a little video here that kind of shows our app. This was done, and I think I hit play. So this, maybe it has music. So here's our app, and we have different lessons. And here's one where you have to rotate this on minus 9, so kind of rotate it clockwise there. And here somebody's drawing the app, the thing on the grid, and they did it, and they did a great job. Is that it? I think it was a pretty quick one, but that basically shows the app. I have the app here. I have an iPad here if somebody wants to try it. What we did eventually at this point is if you get it wrong, you can retry, you can get a hint, you can get a peek. And eventually what we did is if you get it on your own, if you retry as many times as you want, but you don't look at it or peek, you get 3 stars. If you use a hint, which means a hint shows us the partial solution, what is the correct line, 2 stars. If you have to peek at the solution, we still make you complete the assignment correctly, draw it out. But then that shows you what you got right, what you, green is right, red is wrong, and blue is what you didn't draw in. Get 1 star. Here's kind of a picture of that in action. So here we're just copying this cube in 3D. I only drew part of it. This line's a little too long. If I hit peak, I just show the correct aspects. If I do hint, I just show the correct lines. If I do peak, I show the correct lines, the incorrect lines in red, and the final solution here in blue. So that pretty much tells me the answer. And we kind of made it that you had to try twice to get a hint and then 2 more times to pick up the solution. And test assignments at the end of the chapter where we disabled it. These features you'll find out were added a bit later, and you'll see why. Now, there's a lot of assignments that we did. They started in drawing in 3D. This shows the front, side, and top views. This is going from the 2D views to the 3D views. We have some angled lines. We do some rotations about one axis. We do take this object and rotate about the x-axis and the y-axis. So there are a wide range of assignments that you can do. Lessons learned in the classroom. So we got our grant. Our first grant was from Cal IT2 in 2012. It took us about a year to get our software working, and our first trial was in spring 2014. So this is what the data that we had. So on the first day of class, we gave the standardized Purdue test on spatial visualization. It takes 20 minutes, and we did it also at the last day of class. And you can look at the whole class average, but that kind of hides a bunch of things. So we looked at the average all groups. We had 52 students. And they scored about 78% in the beginning, then 82%, an average increase in 7. But you learn a lot more if you break it up into groups. So we kind of divided it into a low group, a low 70%, a mid group, and a high group. And so first of all, you notice that among the high group, the group that stores 93%, that's out of the standardized test. You really can't, if you miss one mistake there, you don't have a lot of room to grow. You can go down. So actually, they went down a little bit. Once you're in the high group, your scores can't go up. The mid group went up by 12%, but the low group, these are the group that people believe are at risk of dropping out. These are the group that could benefit most from this, is they increased by 18%. Now, these groups still indicated in their surveys that they learned a lot in the class, but we wanted to look more closely at this group because we think even this 18% doesn't tell the full story. So we looked more closely at the individual students, and I think we had 13 students. And it just was, usually you plot statistics, you don't write each individual case out, but these are individual students here. These persons started at 57, they went to 90, they went to 53, 73, 40, and so on. These, as a group, increased by 43%. But this group here barely increased. Some of them dropped, had a minus 4%. You notice there's nobody in the middle. Nobody increased. This is the highest here is 6%, and the lowest here is 29%. It was just complete bimodal distribution. Something was going on here, right? So this number 13 isn't huge. But when you see such a strong trend in the data, you have to look a little bit more. So we said, what is the difference between these two groups? And what we found out, that the percentage of assignments attempted, about the same. Percent correct on the first attempt, that was an indicator. But by far the biggest indicator was that the percentage tried again without peaking. That had a 74% difference. These people, and you notice that even this group that had significant improvement still peaked. If you get stuck, the teacher isn't right there, you peak. The peaking was a useful feature, but that was the biggest difference. So now, this is interesting because it makes sense, right? That the more persistent you are, you don't just look at it, that you're going to learn more. But it completely surprised me that the result was this huge. This group here, if I go back to this previous slide, we were almost wasting these students' time if it would just look at the standard visualization test. They also learned other things and so on. But what a huge difference. And people talk about persistence. Here's a picture. We looked at some. So what we did is every time a student submits it, we actually look at what they did. Here they had to draw this shape. And you notice that this student just did two little lines, and then they peaked. And they had no improvement in the post-test. These people did five attempts. You see what they counted. They made this one a little bit too long. And they did not give up. But finally, they peaked. Insights, and so this is a predictor of success. So student effort, some people call it persistence, some people call it grit. And the interesting thing is so much stuff of online is multiple choice. Multiple choice will not give you this information. We weren't planning on this, but we found that out. Because if I do a multiple choice test once, I can't do it again. If I do it again, I've already eliminated one of the choices, right? But sketching by its nature isn't multiple choice. You have this opportunity to try again so you can identify persistence. This caught the attention of other people. We published it, I think, in 2015. It got an award. And I think part of the reason why it stood out from the crowd is that suddenly we have a way to measure persistence. Now, just because we can measure persistence, we thought that's great. But really, we want to help and increase it. So we thought, well, at least you can see, if you're a teacher, you can see that this student is peaking too much, and you can go over and encourage them and work with them. So at least it'll be a predictor. But we also wanted to increase persistence. And I always thought this was very difficult. We have so many things, right? Do more exercise, eat healthier, all these things, go to sleep earlier. You have these things on your watch and on your bed and all these things. Can you really change performance? So we actually wrote down what were some of the risks of doing this whole initiative, and that was one of them. But the hint and so on that I showed you, originally we just had peak. We didn't have hint, then peak. We didn't have the stars. We actually redid our assignments so they gradually increased in difficulty. We had added test questions, and then we modified our questions. So these results were just summarized as of a month ago, okay? And what it is, we taught in 2014, 2016, and 2017. And these are the people who scored low. So these are their average scores, and their average scores have increased. So each score, has gone up each year as we've improved our app. Each time we've made different modifications to our app. But look at these numbers here. We decided which are the group of students that we have over 10% improvement. We call these significant learners. We started out with just 46%, and now we're at 82%. So our numbers could be higher, but it really is promising, and it's very exciting. And these are the first place we presented this data. Let's look at this. So we also asked the students if they like it. And there's people kind of like it, but I'll tell you one thing. If you have buggy software, so this automatic grading sounds very simple, right? It just, you grade it. Well, basically, you're trying to duplicate what a human teacher is doing. That's not that easy. We have a lot of intelligence with us. And so if I'm a sloppy drawer and I don't draw my line straight, or if I'm drawing on an iPad and my palm of my hand hits it and I have a little mark, a human teacher will not grade it wrong. Let's say the kid knew what they were doing, right? But the algorithm, if the algorithm isn't right and it grades you too harshly, boy, will you annoy the students. They're working so hard and so on. So little changes helped. And our last one, we got 96% with some students did some comments. They like, in general, people like the class. It was a one unit pass, no pass class. It didn't help anybody graduate. Just the fact that they came back each week was pretty good. So the students like it. Let's look at things we learned from the teacher interface. And I just was putting this up earlier, and I just actually remembered one of them that I forgot to put in the presentation. But basically, this is what a teacher will see on the web page. So I have my students, and I can see student 3 is doing the most in the class. This shows how much progress they have. Student 7 here, they did 5 assignments, but they peaked a lot. Yellow means they peaked the medium a lot. So I can see what they do, how much they do. I can also click on them and see the individual assignments of what they do. And I can actually see the individual sketches. And the site was just down. I was going to show some examples from it. But one thing we learned is students and actually teachers do not read instructions. We say, you know, for the side view, you have to put the side view next to the aligned, the front view. Let's see, you do the front view, then the side view. They have to be exactly aligned. People just will pass by. They won't read any of the instructions you write. But if they get it wrong, they'll pay attention to that. And so instead of trying to put so much effort into our instructional material, we switch and try to teach as much as you can. If you get it right, just keep on moving. But if you get it wrong, then you'll pay attention. So we consciously change our learning. This was an interesting one here. We started with something really easy. We thought, why don't you take this shape here? I remember what I wanted to show. And we say, rotate it 90 degrees. Okay? And what we wanted students to do, and the correct solution is this, is I'll draw the correct solution in green, is to simply draw this. And that shows that that is a 90 degree rotation. But there's an and you may have drawn this correctly, but there's an alternative interpretation that you could do. So how else could you solve that problem? What? What? Well, you could draw it right over the top, but you could, let's say you draw this green line correctly, but your mental way of getting to this this correct shape was different. You flip it. You could just take this, and it's 90 degrees in this plane, right? So it's 90 degrees this way and 90 degrees that way. And we didn't notice that, except when you get to another assignment, right? So for example, if the next assignment was to draw it like this, and you would have, the correct way to do this is, oops. That's, where's the green? The correct way to do this one would be like that. And then, the incorrect way of flipping it the other way would put it that way. Now, if this was done on paper and pencil, you probably still could have figured that out, that was causing difficulty. But when you have so much data, all of it together, especially if you're a teacher, you give your TAs to grade it and so on and so forth, you may never notice that. So that was one thing we figured out. Another one that I forgot to mention is that we always use this reference dot. This reference dot tells us where to do the sketch. And we may have an interesting shape. I'll do this one. I don't know, maybe I'm going to draw something. Hopefully I got that right. So I could draw the reference dot here. I could draw the reference dot here. Alternatively, I could choose to draw it here. I could draw it any place. It turns out that the students always started drawing where the reference dot was. It makes it easier. Theoretically, you could count down and get to that, but you can see it would be pretty hard. And when we get to these rotations about two axes, we realize we were forcing people to think in a certain way. And this was done and observed by observing the students and talking to the students. So if you just look at the final image, you can't see where they started and where you didn't. But by watching students, talking to students, we did that. And finally, we're going to allow people to move the sketch around so that we're not dictating a certain way of thinking. We once tried to make it very easy, just doing dashed lines, and that worked okay. But if it's too easy, then people get confused. And finally, just using colors turned out to be a big deal. When everything was done on paper and pencil, and there was a big debate, actually, because I'm on this grant that I'm with working with other people, everything is done on these 30-degree lines, and so you may have some grid lines that you draw on, but it turns out if you do it on a photocopied sheet of paper and you're drawing with a pencil, it gets hard to distinguish a line from what you're drawing. So just adding color allowed us to do things that other people weren't doing. So that's where some of the things we got from the teacher interface. Let me talk a little bit about the commercialization effort. So we did iCorps. So iCorps is a program. It's done nationally, but it's also done here at UC San Diego. And I don't know if it's still ongoing. And it can be undergraduates, graduate students, faculty. I went there. I think I was the only faculty person doing that. We would all present. Most of them were undergraduates, a few graduate students, and we get criticized by all our ideas. It was great. The great thing about these things, and in fact, doing this whole project, is you always need a deadline to push you forward, right? And so we would have to go, and one of the things we'd have to do is we'd have to interview potential customers, because so many people have these great ideas about these great products that you're going to make, but it may not address a real need, or may address a need, but it's not a need that people really, really care about. Call it compelling need. So we were forced to do that, and we did it here at UCSD. That helped us write our grant for the SBIR, Small Business Innovative Innovation Research Grant. We had to do that again. So one thing we found when we started talking to people, we heard people in the biology department say, I love for all my biology students to take spatial visualization. If they're dealing with enzymes, and what are the molecules that go into the specific location of the enzyme? Activation site, is that what it is? It's been a long time. Right, and then three dimensions of chemists do that, and everybody said it would be great. But if you go to a biology professor and you say, excuse me, do you really need to cover mitochondria on this lecture day? They're going to say, of course I need to cover that. I don't have a lot of room for that. So one thing we learned, even though a lot of people had enthusiasm for it, it would require a lot of change in people's activity to adopt our software, and one thing that requiring customers to change behavior is difficult. We even talked to somebody in the Del Mar School District who thought first graders, it would be great for them because now they're learning how to do addition. They have to draw in groups of 10 different blocks and things like that. So a lot of people said, this is great, you could do so much with it. But we decided to focus. When you're starting a company, you want to choose one group that you can feel confident you can sell to get at least some income and get some traction. So we decided we're going to talk to engineering CAD classes. And so I knew other engineering CAD professors. I talked to them and I'd show them my baby and they showed, that looks great. I love it. But if you go to the iCorps, they say you can't talk to your friends. Okay? You have to go talk to people that you don't know. So I emailed, I went to San Diego State, USC, UCLA, Stanford, Berkeley, San Luis Obispo, wide range of different schools. And the first thing that was, I introduced myself with an email, is most people email me back. That was relatively surprising. And they had long conversations about students today, some of them complimentary, some of them students are hardworking, some of them they don't feel they are so much. But we learned quite a lot. Our whole premise of our whole project is we're going to help people's spatial visualization ability, right? And I could ask them, you know, was that a good thing? First of all, I asked them, what is spatial visualization? Some people said they didn't know the term. Some people said it had to do with wearing 3D goggles. And so even though you go to a conference and everybody's talking about spatial visualization so important, you have to realize that those people who go to that conference and are familiar with your terms are really a small subset of the population. People have been teaching CAD classes for decades, okay? And they weren't familiar with that term. I asked, what about your graduation rates? Faculty, we honestly don't know what the graduation rates are. Students enroll, we see them in the class, we give out our grades. Maybe we see some a few years later, maybe we don't. We don't track who graduates, who don't. And a lot of the faculty actually weren't aware of the graduation rates that they had. So our whole premise that we're going to teach spatial visualization to improve your graduation rate wasn't going to be a strong marketing message. But then we talked a little bit more. Oh, and we asked them, where do they learn about their, how do they get their textbooks and so on. Well, you know, 30 years ago, I learned, you know, fluid mechanics, and I had to teach it again, so I used the same book, but the more recent edition. You know, people just weren't, people may go to a conference in their field, automotive engineering, bioengineering, bridge design. They go, a lot of them don't go to engineering education conferences, which is where we heard about the spatial visualization thing. So it's very easy to be in your own little bubble. But then I talk about freehand sketching. And they universally said freehand sketching is very important, and many of our students do it poorly. So it resonated. Freehand sketching is important. Spatial visualization is important. But we changed our message a little bit. And it's amazing how they felt like nobody in their department understood, you know, the challenges that they go in terms of teaching CAD. They're kind of, you know, some people teach physics, some people do strength and materials, some people do dynamics. They spent hours on the phone just chatting, and some in person about that. Now, so that was instructors. Student discovery, so we also talked to students. You guys are students. It's interesting, and you guys can correct me if I'm right on, we interviewed seniors, juniors, sophomores, freshmen, and we found a difference, and I think the difference is because things are changing rapidly. The seniors, I asked them, do they buy textbooks? No. They get them on, somehow they find a PDF. Okay, maybe they'll buy a used textbook so they can read it during finals week without getting distracted on the computer. And that's all, they just don't pay for textbooks. But at the freshman and sophomore level, people started, oh yeah, my math class required me to pay for this $50 account or $100 account. How many people have had to pay for something, an account? So it's happening, whether it's good or bad, I'm just telling you what it is. We asked them what they thought about the software. Some people liked it, some people didn't. So the whole model of the income is shifting from textbooks to people trying to get accounts. So it found out that paying for software accounts is becoming more popular, and it's a relatively rapid change, so rapid that here seniors didn't necessarily experience it, but freshmen are experiencing it over the last 4 years. The other thing is we asked if people have iPads. Some of them did, but a lot of them were the hand-me-downs from their family. They didn't necessarily buy an iPad to use at UCSD. But they all had smartphones, so we actually did, but we didn't know if the screen would work well enough. So we did called a minimum viable product. We mocked it up on a screen. It didn't have the automatic grading algorithm, but everything it had. The students said it worked fine for them. They preferred the larger screen of the iPad, but they were able to do it on the smaller screen. Some schools, we talked about them, some schools require engineering students to have Windows computers. Other schools allow for a mix. So when we started this project 4 years ago, iPads were the dominant tablet, and that has changed. And so customer discovery is important. Now, let me go. So now, about 20% of the people we talk to do go to engineering education conferences. So in June 25, 28, We're going to be there with our software. You can ask me after that how it went. But our target is to make a big show there and to hopefully get people adopting the software in the fall. And that's where the reality meets. I think the definition of a company, Jay can correct me if I'm wrong, is if you have a paying customer. And so we'll see if we have that. Let's talk a little bit about our team. So myself and Professor Vandenide, we've been working on this together. She's a structural engineer, and she also teaches introductory design. Lizzie Cowan, I think, worked with Scott. She's been a huge help with ours. We designed it without any UX designer, and I thought it just looked fine. And then now that somebody has really looked at it with some design expertise, and there was some A-B testing, and we put buttons in the wrong place, and people made little mistakes that frustrated them. We've been in the classroom for almost 4 years, and it really, really has improved. Bob needs to send me a better photo, but he teaches CAD in Illinois, and it's also part of our NSF project. And Nan Rennard, Professor Renner, teaches here, and she's done some classes here. You may know her from some cognitive science classes, but she's helped with observing students and really learning about that whole cognitive. It's a mental process trying to learn, and so that insights with moving the dot really helped with her. We had a lot of people help. You may recognize some of the people here from the program, and I probably have forgotten a few people. But this whole project would not have been possible, I think, without the institutional support and learning from this design group here. And so it's been beneficial for me and fun to learn. The funding, things makes it so much easier to start something here when you have a campus. So we have the Academic Senate, Cal IT2, a bunch of acronyms here, which are mostly education, to promote educational here on campus. And finally, we had NIH. That must have been a small. I don't think that's the NIH. But we definitely got our biggest grant from the, maybe it was, but I got our biggest grant from the NSF. And that's what we're doing right now. I thought what I would do is I would just plug in and show a little bit more of the app. I can unplug this. That's good. You guys gonna see my code? Mm-hmm. I can use my fingerprint. My code's not there. this is the one that you saw before. I'll just do it quickly. You know, I can hint. I can peek. But I wanted to show, some of these are rotations about one axis. Here we added multiple choice to it because we realized multiple choice does. We originally felt so great that we took multiple choice out, but we actually put them in. We added some round shapes. Here's a relatively simple shape. If I submit it, I hit peak, it's rotated at 90 degrees. Oh, here were the one, again, we got some suggestions here to make it look a little bit like a character, can help us represent shapes. And that was definitely input from the cognitive science group here. We did rotations about two axes. These get much more difficult because you have to rotate about one axis than the other axes. And so it gets pretty complicated pretty quickly.
Nate, do you ever show the animation of the actual rotation?
So in one of our apps, we do show the animation, and I'll show that in a little bit. For this one, we haven't done that yet. We're actually hoping not. We want to make it one step, but we want the animation to be active, so you actively are engaged with making that animation. I'll get to that in a minute. We want to do most of the assignments were traditional, but this was a new category of assignments that we developed. Call it assembly because if I'm thinking of putting stuff together, then why do spatial visualizations for a task? So this kind of comes from a game called the Soma Cube, which is different shapes, and this is pretty easy. You just put that shape in that place there, but you can see that you know, you can do it with two pieces. You can steal two pieces, I guess. These are the final ones. You know, you can have three pieces and going to get pretty complicated. We have to change a little bit of our shading a little bit on that. We also felt that people traditionally learn it when they're at a younger age, then they can, then they could do it lower age. So this is like for fourth grade and fifth grade. This has a little bit of animations. This, at least in my generation, we like Tetris. This has three shapes. I can submit this one if I do a peak. Well, this is interesting. Oh, I know, if I do hint, this will kind of show some of the animations that go through. But again, this is passive. We want to make it a little bit more active. We have the traditional 2D views. We have some of these animations that do that. But our next step is to make it more active. But that really kind of, oh no, I have to show one more thing. I want to make it fun. So we thought, what do kids like? I chose something I thought were gender neutral houses. So you learn how to draw a house, and then you put in the windows and the doors and stuff like that. So I think that's it. So okay. Well, thank you very much.